Welcome back. So we've talked about quite a lot of different asset classes or asset types. We've done a risk profile questionnaire, and these become the starting point for now creating an asset allocation or a portfolio for your investments. Now, remember that this should be the subject of a discussion. It's definitely not the be-all and end-all of what your asset allocation or portfolio should look like. So what is asset allocation exactly? It's just a framework of how much of your investments should go into each of those asset baskets that we've talked about earlier. You know, the cash, fixed interest, Australian shares, international shares, and property. And remember that each of these have a different benefit, like liquidity or safety or franking credits. And each of them also has a different risk or downside, whether that's that shares go up and down a lot more or whether that returns are typically lower over time. And it is a balance between the risk that you're happy to take and the returns that you need to get from your investments. As you can imagine, the assets that give you the least risk, like cash, are also going to give you the least return over a long period of time. It's worth remembering that whenever we talk about returns, we're talking about the long term. Anyone that tells you that they know what the market's going to do in the next 3 months or 6 months isn't being completely honest with you. There are no crystal balls in this investing world, even though I really wish there were sometimes. Usually when we talk about asset classes then, we're going to divide them into two baskets. One is income or defensive assets, and the other is growth assets. Generally speaking, your growth asset classes are the ones like equity, property, and infrastructure. And to try and get a higher return on these than average defensive assets, they're also going to take a higher amount of risk in order to get those returns. So their prices are going to be more variable. Defensive assets, on the other hand, are things like your cash and your bonds. So they're assumed to have lower average returns than equities, but at the same time, they give you higher levels of safety and less variation in those returns. Often when I talk to people about investments, people get very caught up in choosing the right share or the right stock. The thing to remember is this is a little bit like buying a house. Were you ever told that if you want an investment property, you should be buying the worst house in the best street? Choosing an investment is a little bit the same. You actually want to get the suburb right first, or the portfolio asset class. So if you get your asset class right, you know, is Australia going to be better than the US? Or is fixed interest going to do better than cash? So you want to get your suburb or asset class right first. Then we can look at the street in the suburb. What sectors are stronger than others? Is healthcare better than telecommunications? What's the outlook for the banking sector? What's going to happen to retail if online shopping trends continue? So we've got our suburb or our asset class right, our street, so the sector within that asset class, and then we can look at the house itself or the investment. Now that we know what street or sector we want to be in, which particular company or investment looks the best in that sector? If you buy the best Australian share, but the entire share market falls like it did in the GFC, it did not matter that you had the best one. It still went down. So asset allocation is actually an incredibly important part of your whole investment process. From there, we'll usually create a benchmark asset allocation that will suit different people. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to suit that original risk profile questionnaire that you did, because remember I said that's a starting point for discussions. But it does help create a framework around how much of your money should you have in defensive assets, so things that are nice and safe but slower or lower returns, compared to growth assets. Then underneath the defensive assets, how much should you have in cash compared to fixed interest? In growth assets, how much should we have in international equities or Australian equities or property? Each of these will have different investment objectives, but they should also have different investment timeframes. The more volatile an asset class is, so the more it goes up and down, the longer you should be able to hold that asset class, which is why age starts to play an important part in creating that asset allocation basket for you. For us, we believe that having a balance of different types of investments and assets within your portfolio is really important. Knowing there's no crystal ball in investment markets, you don't want to have all of your eggs in one basket. The key is actually to have different assets that perform differently in different environments. That way, you'll be able to smooth out returns over a period of time. One thing that performs best in one quarter or 1 month or even 1 year might not be the best that performs the next year, but when you add that into the other things that you hold, they're going to give each other a good balance. So that gives you a good overview of how we'd create an asset allocation, because next we're going to start talking about, with your investments, where's the best place to hold those, and how super might play into that for you as well.